Who has already tried Compute Engine? Since it has been announced for open sign up only at I/O, so now 3 weeks ago, I can understand because it was a limited preview before. So, which means we had to manually activate the product because it has been announced last year at I/O, but now it's really something you can try this year. So, a bit of background, we've been working on, for us, it's a very strategic product, okay? Ultra strategic product. I think you all know Amazon EC2. I guess most of you maybe have already used. You understand that we are going into that space. So this is a big space. We've been working for 3 years on the virtualization technology behind Compute Engine. So it's not a copy of what you can find in other places. It's really unique to Google. So from the bottom up, you know, what Urs was explaining is that we, because of our scale, we had to build our products, we have to design our server, we have to build our network layers, and our machines is the same. So the operating system, you know, we take what we find, the best, we strip it, and then we customize it because this is our own hardware. So at all the layers, this is Google-only technology, okay? We don't use Apache, we don't, maybe for internal stuff, but for the product, we have rebuilt web servers, file system, as you can see, really from the bottom up. So that's why this virtualization layer is completely optimized for our platform, our servers. And what we see, and I hope that we will try Compute Engine, is that we managed to have a very low footprint, which means between the physical performance and the virtual performance, there is always, you know, a little loss because there is a virtualization layer running on the machines. Here, the footprint of this loss is very, very, very thin because we've been optimizing that. So you almost have the physical machine's performance. And what is also important is that we've been working a lot, that was in the early specifications, on what we call the noisy neighbors problem. And the noisy neighbors is that with virtualization cloud, virtualization technology you have on public cloud, usually you have an instance, virtual instance, running on the physical machines, but you are not alone, of course. You have neighbors, so other customers that are running their own virtual instance on the same physical machine. And let's assume there is a bit of overbooking when your neighbors, so collocating on this physical machine, are hitting hard, so maybe they have a peak of load. You will see your own performance dropping, okay? That's something we want to avoid with Compute Engine. We've been working hard on that to do live migration of machines when a physical machine becomes noisy. So you have your performance from day one to the end. And you have constant performance over time. You don't have performance loss. The boot time and the availability time as well is really important. You will see in the demo, you have your machine in 20 seconds, more or less. And we try to, so 20 seconds from the time you click new machine to the time you can SSH the machine. Okay? So it's not 5 or 10 minutes, it's 20 seconds. And the boot time is really fast, like it's less than 20 seconds because there is a staging provisioning time before. We try to go, our objective is always to have a zero, but you know it's impossible, but we're trying to go below 1 second. So we are working really, really hard on Compute Engine. There is a lot of announcements at Google I/O that we made, like we are providing now load balancing, so level 3. We are providing advanced routing. We are providing automation. So there are a lot of features coming on the product. Okay, so few slides and then demo. What is the what are the use cases again about Compute Engine? So the first one, hence the name Compute Engine, was compute. The idea of you can launch any number of virtual machines using Linux. So today we support Debian, CentOS, and we have a core OS, which is GCEL, Google Compute Engine Linux, which is like Ubuntu, let's say. And we're going to support more operating systems over time. I can't disclose, like in a public audience, what we're going to support, but in the following months, we're going to support more operating systems. Okay. That you all know. The idea is that it's not only the machines, it's really about, again, as always on cloud platform, the network. The machine-to-machine networks is incredible. It's like you are at less than 1 millisecond and you can transfer terabytes you know, at a terabyte per second. Of course, you have the physical limit of the hard drive. What I'm saying is that there are almost no limit from the network perspective. The storage, so there are a new, two new storage mechanisms. We've been talking about cloud storage, but you also have the local storage on the machine that will live with the machine, meaning that when you create the machine, you have this disk. So it's usually it's hundreds of gigabytes, depends on how many cores you want on your machine. And I will show you after during the demo. But you have also something I mentioned earlier, which is a persistent disk, which is a shared storage, like a SAN, if you want, across machines. And there's a lot of tooling. As always, you can use the web REST API to create your machine. You can use the command line, so gcutil, similar to the gsutil I showed earlier. Or you can, from the UI, create the machines. And that's something I will do as well, because I need something quite visual for you. Okay. Easy. I've talked about all of this: scale, performance, value. So that's the overview of what you get with Compute Engine. So of course, you get what's right here, so the virtual machines, but you get a private network within Google, and you can do subnetworks, as many as you want, set your own firewall rules. Okay, and you really—I hope you all understood that you are root on this machine. So this is your machine running in Google infrastructure. That's really the idea. So you do whatever you want. And they are, of course, connected to internet, so you can host, a website on Tomcat, if that's what you want to do. Ah, maybe you can't read very well. So this one was persistent disk, this one was local disk, and this one is cloud storage. So the three main storage mechanisms we provide. And the three access types, so the command line, the web UI, and from the code, so the API itself. So either the REST HTTP API or using a client implementation. Again, Java, .NET, PHP, you name it. So what we call the project is where all the machine will be linked, you know. It's not physical stuff. It's really a way to organize your different applications. So in one project, you have all your machines. You can create another project if you want to separate. And within this project, you have your own persistent disk, local disk that comes with the machine, network, etc. And which each project has an ID. Okay. So the machine. So as I said, root access, there are stock images you can use, or the idea is that you could build your own images. We are running modern processor, of course, so this is Intel Sandy Bridge. These are the virtual cores that you can have from one. And even now, we have launched at I/O new, very small models. So like if you do dev, like we call them small and micro, I will show them. But basically, you have from 1 to 8 virtual cores. And per CPU, that's the RAM you get. And we have various profiles. So we have what we call the standard, which is this ratio. We have high memory, so you have more memory per core. And we have high CPU, so you have less memory per core. I don't know what happened. Up, next.
Is it possible the RESTful API to create a custom virtual machine, such as just one virtual CPU with a huge amount of RAM?
Not yet, no. The question was, can I create a custom machine from the API specifying the number of CPU? You have to go into the types. I will show on the demo what types of machine we provide.
I've read the page about the configuration, but there are standard templates.
Yeah.
There is a template with one virtual CPU and a small amount of RAM and a small amount of hard disk. Maybe I would like to have a machine, maybe for a NoSQL database, with a huge amount of RAM, but with a small number of CPUs.
That's the high memory profile. So I will show you all the profile. I think you will see that we are trying to address the main use cases. This high memory profile, what you're talking about. So let me finish with this slide so I can show you that right after. So external IPs, of course, you can choose to add your own IPs, and which are external IPs for this machine to listen on internet. We are doing, of course, one-to-net nating and firewall. I will show everything on the console. This is the persistent disk, so of course there are zones, I forgot to mention, but when you create your machine, you choose if you want to deploy it in US East, US Central, or West Europe. We will bring more availability zones, of course, like in APAC, because we are today, GCE is not deployed in all the data centers that we have. So it's only the first ones. We are bringing more zones so you can deploy really your application closest to your customers. And everything is encrypted in terms of storage at rest, and even machine-to-machine transfer are encrypted. So which gives you another idea of the performance. We are not even slowed by the encryption. So the ephemeral disk, so the local disk, if you want, it lives and dies with the instance. That's the idea. When you create your instance, if you are in a compute scenario, you don't care of the machine and what's on the machine. You just create. Then maybe you want to set up a launch script that will configure the machine. Then the machine will do some computation. If you remember the use case earlier with mobile and backend and VM engine from App Engine, that's typical the case. You create a machine, it's going to do his job, and then you destroy the machine. And you don't care on what's on the machine. So for that kind of use case, you can use a local disk, because it will die with the machine. If, however, you need to persist the data generated by the machine, then you want to use the persistent disk. And you can boot a machine from persistent disk. So that's really key. So you can really, because you want to minimize your cost. So when you don't need the machine anymore, you will destroy it. As it takes 10 to 20 seconds to get the machine again, there is no need to let the, it's like the light. When you go out of the room, you switch off your light. That's really the idea of a compute engine. You don't want to spend money for a machine that is doing nothing, of course. So that's why you need to manage the data, of course. And the cloud storage, so we just talked about cloud storage, that's of course integrated with Compute Engine. So you can easily store terabytes of data or petabytes of data from Compute Engine, and that was the case in the big migration use case I was showing before. And the three access doors you have, so UI, command line, and from the API. As you can see, so I won't go into too much detail here. We've covered that more or less. So Compute Engine is really is in most of our big architecture diagrams. So you see it here. It's a Hadoop, MapReduce use case. Here it was the thing of this morning I was presenting when you want to do batch processing for your mobile app on demand, etc., etc. So there are many. This is an analytic pipeline. So you have a lot of data coming in. You use App Engine for MapReduce, and then you want maybe to also use Hadoop to analyze this data. So Compute Engine is everywhere. I mean, everyone needs virtual machines at one point. It's very, very rare that no one that you don't need it in your project. And before going into the demo, so we already have, of course, an ecosystem. RightScale is one of the first partners, so they know very well Compute Engine. They have their own image, because that's the idea. You can start from a standard machine, so a stock image, then you can customize it, and then you can take a snapshot, of course. You put it on cloud storage, and then you will reuse it to reboot a new machine. So you have your own machines in your project. So in RightScale, so they are providing their own image, and they add on their image a connector that connects to their central console. The idea is to have elasticity, so scalability up and down at infrastructure level. We provide that with App Engine. As you know, it scales up and down. You don't have to worry about how many machines you need to run your app. When you are at infrastructure level, you have to manage that. So do I need to put more machines behind my load balancer? So do I need to remove some machines because now I don't have the demand for all these machines? So RightScale is doing that for you. You just configure, you say, I don't know, you define some threshold. You say at above 70% of usage, I want you to add 5 more machines, and the rest, the inverse rule. So when you go below 50%, you remove 3 machines. You know, you define your own rules, and RightScale will manage the scalability, so from the console, directly on Compute Engine. And they do also a lot of monitoring stuff. These are other partners, technical partners. MapArm is a commercial Hadoop implementation. I have a project with them. I was mentioning Cdiscount earlier. So they are using MapR for a Hadoop project to analyze their traffic on the website and improve their conversion ratio. So it works very well. We broke the Tira sort record. It was 1 minute something. With Compute Engine, it's now less. It's like 56 seconds. So it's to give you an idea of the pure performance of Compute Engine. Oh, I won't go into that. It's the big data landscape. Okay, let's go on the demo for the last 15 minutes. So I have to sit down again, sorry. And then I will take, of course, questions. Okay? So let me clean that up. So you start from here. What is that? Yeah. Hope you see. So this is the console homepage for a project. The console, let's go, so you can understand really how it works. You go on here with your Gmail account, you activate the services you want to use, and then you create your project. And here I am logged with my corporate account, Google, so we see we have some project internally that are shared with me, and I have access to this one, which is our demo collateral. Here you see the services that are activated for this project, so which means the project is like a team, you know, you can share the project with other people in your team, like you are sharing a doc in Google Doc, and give specific access to everyone. So App Engine, so it means that on this project we have, people using some App Engine instances, Compute Engine, and we will go into that, Cloud Storage, BigQuery, some APIs, Cloud SQL. So there you see which services are being used. So let's focus on Compute Engine, and let's do a quick tour of the administration console. Here you can see a basic monitoring graph that is showing nothing is happening. It's a demo of environment. It's not, there is no external user. And we will give it some loads during the next demo. You can see the network traffic as well that is that we have monitored, and the disk traffic. Okay. You will see here, let me zoom. That's a sample machine. So that's the name of the machine. The machine is running. You see the profile of the machine, one CPU, 3.8 gigabyte of memory. Where is the machine? So it's in US Central, this one. How many persistent disks are attached to this machine? What is its external IP address? And on which network? So that's the default network, but you can create other networks with other rules on which the machine is deployed. And the images that the machine is using. And here you see there are some Ubuntu, GCL. So that's a few machines we get on the project. Machine doing fractal stuff, which is the point of the demo after. You see there are some right image, so I guess it's right scale. And you see all your machine, in which state they are, etc. So now let's focus on the machine. So that one, for example. So you have a, you can put some tags on your machine, okay, if you want to organize your machine that way. Again, as I said, you set a zone, external IP, internal IP, disks that are attached to the machine. So this one is a small one, 10 gigabytes. She had read and write access. You can add metadata, which is useful when you want to use a launch script, etc., with the API. And then you will see the permissions the machine has with other services. And you can recognize storage, task use, BigQuery. So that's why I said we have integrated the product to each other. So let's create one machine right now, so you can see how it works. Test Bastien, ROM, and description, tags, metadata, so you add whatever you want here. There you define where you want the machine to be. So you see you can deploy in Europe or in US Central. Today, and more zones are coming in. So let's go in Europe West B. And back to your question, the types of the machines. So you can see you have the new machines, which are micro and small, and so very small. If you are, you don't need power, like, I don't know, it's like a machine that is doing some networking stuff. You have the high CPU profile, where you see the number of CPU and the low memory per CPU. But if you need a lot of memory, here you can see high MEM profiles, 2 CPU, 13 gigs, or even 8 CPU, 52 gigs. You know, that's the types of machine. You cannot yet define your own type, like I want a 3 CPU or 4 CPU and 50 gigabytes. You have to choose the closest today. Yeah, exactly. And from the API, you can list which are the templates, because we are adding new templates. So you can relist the templates dynamically and say, OK, now I will take that one because it's closest to my requirements. You know, so that's a dynamic list, actually. OK. And And you have other machines with what we call the scratch disk or ephemeral disk. That was in my slide, that, you know, the local storage. I can show them, by the way. So when there is dash D, so you see the machine and its local disk. So let's take, I don't know, anything, high memory profile. Then you can boot from an existing persistent disk. As I said earlier, if you need to work on data you have persisted earlier, or you can take the scratch disk or a new disk that comes with the image. Okay, so let's do that. Then you have the list of the stock image we got. So we build them, you know, frequently. So you can see here we have this is the US. So it's 7th of May, 9th of May for Debian, CentOS, and GCL here. Okay, or you can also save. Sorry. I hope you can see him. If you can't see, raise your hand. Or you can save your own images. So other guys in my team, they chose to create a Tomcat 6, you know, type of server. So it will have Tomcat already pre-installed, because when he did the snapshot, he had already installed and configured Tomcat. Okay. So let's take a standard machine, and then you can add other disks if the machine has to work with shared data. You can add other disks that you have already created. Okay. Regarding the network, so you will define in which network you want the machine to belong. So let's keep the default, and then external IP if the machine has to have an external IP. And here, the access. So what it means is that if you want the machine to have access to storage, in read, in write, no access, or to task queues, we will pre-plug this kind of access. So in your bigger project, if you are using App Engine and Task Queues and you want this machine to work with Task Queues, then you will give it access right now. Okay. Let's create the machine. So that's where everyone cross fingers. But basically, so it's loading. It's going to stage the machine into Europe West, which is 20 milliseconds from here, I think. And then we will see it directly in the list. I have an error, but it's not the same page. It's not my console, don't worry. It's still creating a machine. It's another, and that's the demo I will do, by the way, right after, hoping this one will work. In this demo, we're going to create one, and here we're going to create 16, so 17 machines all together using, this is an App Engine app, and it's going to use the REST API, of course, to create the machines. While it's still creating there, the machine. I think in a few seconds, the machine should be there. Here it is. TestVersion Home is being created. So I guess it's alphabetical. Here it is, coming in. In Europe, USB. The machine is there. Okay, quite fast, finally. I didn't measure. I think it was like 20 seconds, something like that. And the machine is available. And if you want to connect to the machine right away, you have the REST. The REST snippet, or you have the SSH command line you can directly use in your terminal. So GCUtil is the equivalent of GSUtil, but for Compute Engine. Let's clear that. I just passed the command line, GCUtil, last version, that's the project, Google Platform Demo, SSH, in that zone, the machine I just created. Okay. So there is, normally what would happen, it would ask for login password, but no, because we have integrated everything. So this is using auth. Yeah. It's not visible. And I'm going to zoom like this, maybe.
No, but you can just ah, sorry. The so you can enlarge the font. Yeah, great.
Okay. That's okay now. Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Okay,
good idea. Good idea, Alfredo. Okay. So I copied the GST command to SSH. And as I said, I didn't have to enter login password, which is ultra painful, by the way, because what I've done is that the first time you run GCUtil, it will send you to a URL. You go to that URL in your browser. This URL will ask you to authenticate against Google. And if you authenticate successfully, it will give you the auth key that you copy-paste back in GCUtil, which means that I have authenticated GCUtil to Cloud Platform on behalf of me. So now, this GCUtil installation on my computer has access to the machines to which I am authorized in the project. Okay? You understand that? It's very convenient because no need to log in to remember password or whatever, and it's even more safe. Okay? So we are on the machine, so usually the demo stops there, of course, because I don't see I don't have much things to show here. I don't know. Let's check if the memory is the right one. So we have our 26 gigabytes. Okay. What about the CPU? I need to. I have a hard time. Okay. CPU info. So here you can see my. It's really big. My CPU number 0, 1, 2, 3. So there are 4 CPUs as we ask. Okay. And you see Intel Xeon CPU. So that's the. You see the technical details of the CPU. So that's the machine is there. I am root. I can do whatever I want of the machine. Okay. So let me do another demo before we finish and take some questions. The demo is nice and visual, and I hope it's going to work. Okay, I don't want to mess up. Okay, not that one. Sorry. So this is an App Engine. This is a demo that has been, I think, showcased at I/O. This is App Engine, okay. And it's, the idea of this demo is really technological demo, okay? The idea is that to start VMs using the API, that's what I'm going to do right now. And I need to show in parallel, sorry, for the demo to be nice to see, this. Sorry, I will have to do something like this. So I want you to see that list. Okay. And then, the idea is to start the VMs. As you can see, it's coming blue here. So on the right, we have a cluster. And on the left, a single instance. And here, on my poor console, because I have unzoom, we should see, as soon as it's going to be refreshed. Sorry, I'm going to force the refresh. Normally, it's live refresh. OK. We're going to see the fractal cluster, which is the one I'm creating, okay, that is being started. Okay, this is this one. And on the right, the machine, once they are green, the idea is that the machine are ready to SSH. The program, so App Engine, still App Engine, is going onto the machines, provision a little program that will run some fractal imagery. So it's pure scientific calculation, so it's using a lot of CPU. And then we will display, if it works, because I see that I'm waiting also for the single instance, display some fractal imagery, and one is a distributed calculation, the other is single, so we see how fast the machine works together. Because that's the type of use case that requires a lot of network also. So the machines are there, that they just got created. I hope I can show. So I don't know why the machine on the left, the single instance, failed. But the idea is that the machine on the right, as you can see here, zooming out, have been able to create their own fractal. Okay. And then you can, it will mark on the right the render time. And it will calculate as long as when I zoom here, okay, with my two fingers, it's calculating the next layer of the fractal. So sorry, the half of the demo here is not working. The idea, imagine that on the left you have exactly the same thing, but only one machine is trying to do the job. Here we have 8 machines doing the same job. So what we see on the left usually is that the average render time is much bigger because she's only one core. And you can zoom, it will calculate. So as soon as I zoom, it's recalculate the fractal and render that in a distributed calculation because all the machines are doing the calculations, okay? And it's really pretty, okay? You see the color layers. So that's the idea on how fast, so how long does it take, I don't know, 30 seconds? And I could say create, 128 machines, it will be the same because it's done in parallel. We do that every day at Google, okay? We have millions. We don't say exactly how much, but we are in the millions range, okay, in terms of size of cores. And then you just stop, and the machine will be destroyed on the left. So App Engine is asking, okay, they are dying right now, is asking for the, I don't know where they are. They should go, maybe they already disappeared because they are already red. No, they already disappeared, but usually you see it live also here. You see, okay, here they are. You see, it's spinning right there. They are dying. Right there, one after one. And now they have disappeared. I hope you catch it. But it has destroyed the machine and then it's ready back for another demo. Okay, I'm done for the presentation. I can take some questions if you have before we go into the coffee break. Yes? We try to pass the mic. Red one mic, please. Thanks.
Ciao, Bastian. It's more a pricing question. If I have some data, some files, terabytes on the cloud storage, and I launch 10 virtual machines which share the data on the cloud storage, do I pay for this internal exchange?
So good questions. So we don't charge for cloud platform service to cloud platform service network exchange.
Okay.
So what it means is that you can do any traffic between App Engine and Cloud Storage and Compute Engine, between Compute Engine machine, between Compute Engine zones, internet network, between Compute Engine and, of course, Cloud Storage. It won't cost you anything in terms of network. Okay. What you will only pay is your 10 terabytes. So
the
one
storage.
Terabyte is $50, so you're going to pay maybe $500, I think. I can show the pricing live.
Okay.
And then you will pay for your machines. Maybe you want to have a look, because the pricing question, I think, is interesting for all of you. It's fully public. Okay, there is, we have nothing to hide right there. We are transparent. So cloud.google.com, as you understand, is the seat to go. This is everything from there. You can find everything. The product explanations, the data sheet, the website to developers, where you can see all the API documentation. And of course, there is the pricing. Okay, and pricing by product. So App Engine pricing is the most complex because we want to be really fair and to really price only what you use. As you can see, you will be priced on demand. By what you are using exactly. If you are using front-end instances, dynamic one, etc., you have a price per hour. Data store API will price every 100k operations. We are very, you know, fine grade for that kind of pricing. For storage, it's very easier to understand. So there is always a free tier. So you can try for free. You have a free tier, 5 gigabytes of storage, etc. So you can try and use storage. We have two types of storage. So the most replicated and what we call durable, reduced availability, less replicated, which is of course cheaper. We do pricing in euro if you want to pay in euro with a contract, etc. And we price, of course, depending on how much you need. So if you are in the, let's say, 100 terabyte range, we will price by gigabyte. This is a gigabyte per month price, that one. So if you are at 10 terabyte, you can see at 54, so $540 per month. And for the network, as we say, everything that goes into Google Network is free. Of course, we charge for the network, so egress network from Google to the internet, to your users. And that's the type of price. But there is no service-to-service cost. So internal Google transfer are free. And then some operation cost, but every 1,000 operation is 1 cent. So basically, you won't see it. And Compute Engine, very key. So that's really important. That's something we announced at I/O. So if you use the machine 6 minutes, we're going to charge 10 minutes. If you use the machine 10 minutes, we charge 10 minutes. If you use it 11 minutes, we charge 11 minutes. You see, so there is a minimum set of 10 minutes, and then we charge by the minute. And then for all the machine types you have seen earlier when I was creating the machine, you have a price depending if the machine is in Europe or US, and you have a price which is per hour, so you can divide by 60 to have the by-minute price. And you have a price for each type of machine, of course, so whether you need or not a local disk on the machine, so that's the size of the local disk. The high memory profile, so you see, 2 cores, 13 gigabytes instead of 2 cores. So it's twice of it almost, up to 52 gigabytes. So here is everything is detailed. And here it's a ratio CPU on memory, but that is bigger. So less memory per CPU. If it's a HPC use case, you may want to use that maybe. And you have the very new one, which are the small one, the micro and the small. So we are under the, you know, we are at 0.021. It's very small. We are at 2 cents an hour. And again, network pricing between our services is or in the same zone is 3. We charge only external network, okay? And then we reduce depending on the amount of network. And as Christophe said, I'm not the commercial, but as Christophe said earlier, if you are interested in a professional contract with support, and you can see there are several support packages, which is there. So we do up to platinum with dedicated account manager for you, etc. But we have the free one, so you can of course access to the Stack Overflow, etc. The silver, so you can do ticket, you can call in, and gold. And gold is like you have a committed response time, and you have all the various commitments here at the pricing detail. And if you are interested by that type of support, if you are in production, you have customers, you need to make sure it's going to be up. It's not just test and development. Then you just contact us right there. That will arrive on the Christophe's table. Okay? So very simple. Everything is there. And on the videos, everything is, if you search for Google I/O sessions, you will find them right here. And you can choose your track. And of course, my track is Cloud Platform. Okay. I think we're good. Maybe you want to have your coffee break now. Thank you very much.